only up the hill, son.
Thank you.
right dead in the eye and said, your story's so touching, it sounds just like a lie.
was a famous trumpet man from out Chicago way. He had a boogie style that no one else could play. He was the top man at his craft. But then his number came up and he was gone with the draft. He's in the army now, a blowing reveille. He's the boogie-woogie bugle boy of Company B. They made him blow a bugle for his Uncle Sam. It really brought him down because he couldn't jam. The captain seemed to understand, because the next day the cap went out and drafted a band. And now the company jumps when he plays reveille. He's the boogie-woogie bugle boy of Company B. A toot, a toot, a toot-dilly, a toot-dilly blows it eight to the bar. In boogie rhythm, he can't blow a note unless the bass and guitar is playing with him. He makes a company jump when he plays reveille. He's the boogie-woogie bugle boy of Company B. He was a boogie-woogie bugle boy of Company B. And when he plays boogie-woogie bugle, he was busy as a buzz bee. When he plays, he makes the company jump A to the bar. He's a boogie boogie bugle boy of Company B. Do-do-do-do-da-da, do-da-da, do-do-do-do. He blows it A to the bar. He can't blow a note if the bass and guitar isn't with him. And the company jumps when he plays reveille. He's a boogie boogie bugle boy of Company B. Every night, and wakes them up the same way in the early bright. They clap their hands and stamp their feet, because they know how he plays when someone gives him a beat. He really breaks it up when he plays reveille. He's the boogie woogie bugle boy of Company B.
So John Waters was the son of a Baltimore banker. He went to West Point, class of 1931. He went into the Armored Corps, and he met a young woman named Bee, and he went to Bee's father one day. He was a crusty major and asked for permission to court her, and the major said, "Waters, I don't know you. Come back in 3 years." Well, that major was George S. Patton. Waters was persistent. He married Bee Patton. Waters was a lieutenant colonel in North Africa. He was captured on February 14, 1943, and would spend the next 2.5 years in prison. He was moved in January 1945 to a camp in northern Bavaria called Hammelburg. Patton, at this point, commander of the Third Army, approaching Bavaria, got word that his son-in-law might be in the camp at Hammelburg. He sent a very ill-advised raid, 300 men, 15 tanks across 60 to 70 miles of occupied Germany.
Handpicked to lead the raiding party is Captain Abraham Baum. Born in the Bronx, Baum volunteered in 1941. and in the past 3 years has climbed his way up through the ranks of the veteran 4th Armored.
I briefed the troops that we were going on this mission to liberate a POW camp, and that we would be leaving in dark.
Designated Task Force Bomb, the raiding party will consist of 57 vehicles and tanks and 314 men. March 26, 1945. Task Force Bomb moves out. Because the mission is top secret, Bomb has been ordered to maintain radio silence.
They would traverse this winding and intricate pattern of roads, passing through towns like Gemunden on the way to Hamelburg, at which point they would open up the camp, estimating that there would only be approximately 300 American prisoners in the camp. They would load them up in their vehicles and then make the return trip. And the thought was that they would be back that evening. Task Force Baum's tanks plowed through the wire of OFLOG 13B, where they found 5,000 men.
Literally thousands of Allied prisoners expect to be liberated. But Baum has only brought enough vehicles to carry 300.
I was sick. They anticipated being released. They were all ready, writing letters to their parents. I mean, they just were terrible. We got him to call, and with minutes after the daybreak came, all hell broke loose.
Sunrise, March 27th. Enemy fire tears into Task Force Bomb.
The Germans reacted very quickly. Waters, when the raiding party approached, was sent out with a white flag and was shot by a German sniper, shot in the hip and very severely wounded. All of the raiders were either killed or captured. Patton subsequently denied that he had sent this raid after his son-in-law. The truth is that it was one of the most ill-advised, harebrained schemes of George Patton's entire career.
Thank you. At this concentration camp in the Gotha area, the Germans starved, clubbed, and burned to death more than 4,000 political prisoners over a period of 8 months. A few captives survived by hiding in the woods. The camp is chosen for a high command inspection led by General Dwight D. Eisenhower. Also present are Generals Omar N. Bradley and George S. Patton. The 4th Armored Division of General Patton's 3rd Army liberated this camp early in April. The generals view the rack that was used by the Nazis to whip the inmates. The general and his party next see the crude woodland crematory, actually a grill made of railway tracks. Here, the bodies of victims were cremated. Charred remains of several inmates still lay heaped atop the grill.
nothing.
Looks to me like there ain't no bridges still up.
What's this here?
It's a bridge.
Even if we make that, we still got a river to cross later on.
Right now our problem is getting through German lines, right?
Right. How?
Well, it's a railroad bridge, ain't it?
Yeah.
Well, and beautiful. We swing down onto the railroad tracks and right over the mother bridge.
And over the mother bridge. Sure. Suppose the bridge ain't there.
Oh, man. Don't hit me with them negative waves so early in the morning. Think that bridge will be there. Mm-hmm. And it'll be there. It's a mother beautiful bridge. And it's gonna be there.
It's still up. No, it ain't. You see what sending out them negative waves did, Moriarty?
Again, don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.